Good evening, everyone. Hi, welcome to Startup Grind Munich. It's our second edition of the Fireside Chat, and the first one for 2017. So I guess we have quite a few newcomers who might not know about our concept and what Startup Grind is. So let me just give you a little bit of an intro before we get into our Fireside Chat. Startup Grind was born in Silicon Valley in 2010. It's a format that is very specific that encompasses monthly event parties around entrepreneurship. So what we do is we invite entrepreneurs, we invite educators, innovators, professors, investors to talk about their journey in building great companies or in helping entrepreneurs build great companies. It started, as I said, in Silicon Valley. It's now present in 200 cities across the world in 85 countries. And for each city, you have a chapter director. And I became, in October, the chapter director for Munich. So welcome to our second edition of this format in Munich. Just a little bit, a few words about me. My name is Sabine Fletchett. I'm actually French. I've been living here in Munich for 6 years. And before that, well, as our guest speakers, I traveled quite a lot. I studied abroad. I actually left France and Paris when I was 21. And I actually never came back for some reason. I went and studied in London, in New York, in Singapore, worked as well in New York, San Francisco, and now Munich. And I guess I share with our guest speaker tonight this quite extensive taste for traveling, for getting exposed to international culture, for working and studying abroad. But this is a bit too much about me. Our guest speaker tonight has been also, as I said, studying and working abroad, been working in different cities, has been a correspondent and a TV reporter for a number of international broadcasters. And this is how he came with the idea of a social network dedicated to expats. Why? Because he actually find the struggle of being an expat himself and build his dream job out of his own needs. So please welcome Malte, Zeeck, the founder of this platform called Internations.
Yeah.
Please.
Hello.
Have a seat. Before we start into our Fireside Chat, just a couple of things. We have a Q&A box, which is somewhere here, sorry, which has an unusual format to be actually a cube, which you can throw away diligently to people who want to ask a question. You just need to be very close to the mic for us to hear you, but we will welcome questions, of course, at the end of our Fireside Chat for anyone who would like to get to know a little bit more about the journey of Malte. Also, just for the people who have some privacy concerns, as you've seen, we will be recording this Fireside Chat. We will be uploading the event on our local channel on YouTube, Startup Grind Local. And as such, if you have some privacy concern, I would try to avoid the camera or the pictures. So, welcome, Malte. How are you?
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me to this Fireside Chat.
Yeah.
I'm very fine. but I have a little cough, so I took that from my children. Excuse me if I'm...
I'm very glad to have you here as well, because apparently 2007 is actually the 10-year anniversary of Internation, this platform for expatriates, dedicated to expatriates. So maybe first, I think people would like to know a little bit about you, mm-hmm. where you grew up, and what you did before actually building such a platform.
Yes, of course. I'm originally from the Rhineland area, from Bonn. I don't know if everyone is familiar with that. That's in the center of Germany, used to be the former capital city. And after my high school, I started studying business in Switzerland, in St. Gallen, a small town with a university. And that's where I basically spent a lot of time, four and a half years, and also did some exchange programs to Milan and to Sao Paulo, where we had cooperating universities, basically.
Okay, we can actually see you.
Yeah, that was exactly my student card I still found.
So you studied quite a lot abroad. What was your like early academic and professional years during that time? What did you experience, did you get from this international exposure?
Yeah, so I was always very passionate about traveling. And I think I got that somehow from my parents that took us on trips from early on. I went to places like Tibet. We went together to South Africa, to Australia, to China, to the US, and traveled all around the globe. Mm-hmm. And this was something that fascinated me, and I really enjoyed that. Enjoyed meeting other people, people from other countries, from other cultural backgrounds. And that was really something that, that really fascinated me. And I intensified that when I was in the 11th grade in Germany. I did a youth exchange program, which took me to the United States, to New York, and I went there on a Rotary exchange program. And I spent there 1 year living in different families to experience the real American life, a real American high school that you know from the movies, yeah, with a football team and the cheerleaders and everything. It was a great experience, and we also were a group of exchange students sharing this experience. And every couple of weekends, they brought us together to share our experience, our worries, our fears, to overcome our homesickness and these kind of things. And this was really a very interesting experience for me. At the end, we even went for 5 weeks on a trip through the United States with more than 400 students from like 50 different nations. And that was a great experience that I really enjoyed doing, to bring together people from different nationalities.
You still have contact with these people?
Yeah,
today?
I do, using different social media channels.
Okay.
And I visited quite a lot of them. Whenever I go somewhere, I see how they're doing. And unfortunately, back then, social media was not that far as it is today. So a couple of them I lost contact, but a few of them I found later.
Okay. Yeah. And then you study, like you came back to study in St. Gallen and then decided to still get this international exposure in your first professional years.
Yeah, so after like high school, I first had to do what in Germany is called the military service.
Okay.
Which was a mandatory thing you had to do, you couldn't get
which
around it.
It doesn't exist anymore, right?
It doesn't exist anymore like this. It's not mandatory. You can sign up for it. And I took the chance to also do that in an international way. So I spent my basic training. That's the 2 months where you have to run with a gun and walk through the mud and all this kind of stuff.
Use the gun?
Yeah, we were shooting, but only at like these paper targets. And I was doing that in the Netherlands, actually. And then afterwards, I spent like 10 months in Italy, in Sardinia. There's a NATO base, which is run by Americans and British and French and English and Italian soldiers. And that's where I was working as a waiter, actually, in the officer's lounge.
Okay.
So it was a perfect time to learn Italian and to spend a lot of time on the beach. I really enjoyed that.
And during your time at St. Gallen, you also had some international exposure, or like how did the university then yours went through? Because this is also kind of a very close ecosystem.
Absolutely. So St. Gallen is a very small, tiny city, which is probably a good environment for learning, but it's not exactly the thing that you're looking for when you're young, fresh out of your high school, and you want to discover the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I found this job, which was offered by Lufthansa, a major German airline, where you could, as a student, basically work as a flight attendant in your free time.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved that, because I could work there basically as a waiter, but it took me to places I would have never gone myself, to like Turkmenistan or to Africa or somewhere else, spending there some time, like 3, 4, 5 days, because you have to relax after such a long flight, you know. And I then studied basically.
You seem very tired on this picture, but.
Yeah, I think that was somewhere in Peru. But I really enjoyed that, doing that. And then once in a while, I came back to St. Gallen to do my exams and study out of the books.
Okay, and then so they're like, okay, you had this tremendous international experience.
Yeah.
You basically was like open to anything corporate-wise, but you still wanted to keep that international exposure when you got your first job.
Yeah, kind of. It took me into the media industry, where I worked for different television stations, mostly for German television stations, but also for international ones, and worked there as an assistant to the editor and also as a reporter. And that brought me to many different countries, reporting from there, living there for some time.
Actually being behind or in front of the camera?
Both. Okay. Both. Yeah, you would do, basically today you do everything on your own. Back then you had your camera guy and the audio guy and then the guy who's cutting it. And today it's more like you have the camera, you have here the microphone, you interview someone, you take it home, you cut it, you edit, you have your story, and then you send it.
Okay.
So that's what I was doing also. And that brought me also to many other countries. And I found it there, again, very challenging to arrive in a place like here in New Delhi, in India, where I didn't know the language. The culture was very different from what I was known in Germany. And I was kind of lost, yeah, and lonely to not have my circle of friends, my family, my colleagues directly. And so I was looking for these other people who were in the same situation, but it was not so easy to find them. I knew I could go to the Irish pub, maybe, that's where popular hangout usually. and I knew there were people from the embassies and from cultural institutes, organizations, companies, but it was not so easy. And that kind of triggered this idea to build this platform.
What were the problems actually that you were experiencing when you were abroad? Was it the homesickness? Was it the fact that you didn't have your own network? Was it just you didn't know the places? Or because in my experience, it's also like all the logistics. You know, you don't know the tax.
Absolutely.
You don't know the moving companies. You don't know how the renting apartments work. So it's also all these advices, right?
Exactly. It starts with a very logistics that everyone knows when he moved somewhere else. You need to find an apartment. You don't know in which area to move and do this administrational stuff. But most importantly was really once being there, meeting other people who were in a similar situation that you could exchange with about all these challenges that you had and basically have a good time. Yeah, build up a network of friends that you could hang out with, make some business partners, people to travel with on the weekends.
So you had kind of the passion to travel. You had the idea of, or like a need to optimize the traveling experience, but you waited a certain time before building this. So you didn't jump right away. Why is that? I've read in an article in I think it was in Gründer Szene, that you knew you wanted to be an entrepreneur. You just wanted to collect a little bit more of the professionalism maybe that you get in a young career.
Yeah. So already in my time in university, me and also a circle of friends, we were very passionate about entrepreneurship and discussed business models and had ideas of how to change the world and different industries. And that was fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
But we eventually decided to first finish our studies. There were a few people who dropped out of university early to start a company. Some failed, some were very successful. But for us it was okay, let's get some real work experience before actually starting ourselves. And that's when we both decided, my co-founder and I, we studied together, we are very
so
close
Philip
friends
from Plateau.
Since then, Philip.
Mm-hmm.
And he went into consulting, he worked for McKinsey & Company for a couple of years, and it took me into this media field. And that was then the idea that we were both very passionate about, yeah, because we saw that it's not only us having this problem, but it's probably a lot of people. And it didn't matter where they're from, the nationality, if they're Americans or British or German or whatever. And it didn't really matter if you were in New Delhi or in Munich or in Buenos Aires. We wanted to make this life a lot easier or make it a great experience to start something. And that's how our mission was born.
Okay, so you basically quit everything and jump.
Yeah, pretty much. I quit my job at the end to the end of the year, 2000.
But that's quite a big leap of faith. I would think that you know, you had the idea, you had experienced the passion, and you had experienced the needs.
Yeah.
What brings you to take such a risk? Like, did you have a little bit of certainty that it would work? I mean, we were in, what, 2006, 2007?
No, I had no certainty, and it was maybe also a little bit naive, but I also didn't have so much to lose because I was, I think, single at that time. I didn't have a family, I didn't have children, so my financial commitment was to maintain only myself. So it was a limited risk, and I knew if this one doesn't work, I do something differently. And there was this Gründungszuschuss, which is kind of the unemployment money that you get when you start something.
Which was still around, exists, I think.
Yeah, it was around 900 euros, I think. And I was living off that, and that was enough to take that decision and go and try for it. I've been in this industry of media and television for some years. I've done that. I loved it. But I wanted to do something different and something where my impact is bigger than there.
And did you give yourself a timeline saying like, okay, you know, I'll try it for 6 months, a year, and kind of that's my milestone to say, okay, then I stop if
yeah,
it doesn't work?
Yeah, that's what you always aim for, that you validate your idea very quickly, you get very fast feedback from the market, reach a proof of concept very early and get funding and everything works. But eventually, everything takes a lot longer. I think all the way from starting working on the idea until going online was around 8 months or so.
And
it was okay for back then. I think today you can be quicker than that.
Let's go back about and talk a little bit about the team, because I always kind of find very challenging to find the right fit. Mm-hmm. If you don't have the same idea, or if you get to know each other through different connections, yeah, and you don't know each other that well. So you knew Philip from university time. Mm-hmm. How did you bring Christian in, and how did that actually fit? Was it kind of a love at first sight, or did you have a little bit of a kind of a trial period? Or
yeah, so Philip and I were close friends from university, and he made very similar experience working for McKinsey on international assignments. So we were like the core team, I would say. And then the first thing was we were thinking, okay, we need someone to build it, yeah, an engineer, someone who can do the real stuff, because we learn business and you don't really learn anything
tangible.
Anything tangible. But the problem was that in our circle of friends, there were only business people. Yeah.
Yeah.
We didn't know the engineers. Which was a big lack, and then we asked around for friends and that knew someone, and then we had a couple of guys that we were introduced to and we talked to them, but somehow the chemistry didn't work out, it didn't feel right. It
so
was
you
not
kind of trust your first impression
yeah,
you get at that point?
Yeah, it has to work on a personal level, and there was not the same level of enthusiasm for our mm-hmm. idea. So we said, okay, let's drop that and let's do it with an agency. Yeah, why not? Let's develop.
So you hired an agency.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, okay.
So we said we can also do it hire an agency who would develop our very first version of the platform, and then maybe at a later stage, we can find the guy who we really think is the right CTO for our company, which we have found by today, of course.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Let's see the website later.
but the time was there where we said, okay, we are two, and we would like to have a team of three. I don't mm-hmm. actually remember quite well why we said it should be more than us, but we saw the need and more manpower there. So we talked to our friends that were enthusiastic about entrepreneurship, and they liked the idea, and they said, yeah, it's a cool thing, and why don't you guys start? I help you out on the weekend, and then later when you have funding, I kind of phase in. So that was kind of a common answer. But we said, no, this is not what we are going to do. We are all in 100%, 100% of our time, or not at all. And that was a very, very, I think, wise decision back then, because it really needed full attention and focus, not only on the weekend,
people who were
but also on
take
the weekend.
The
and
risk.
Yeah, exactly. Or there was another friend who loved the idea when we told it, And he was enthusiastic, yeah, let's go about it. I will just go home and talk to my parents about it. I mean, we were still very young then. So these things needed to be discussed. Mm-hmm. Dropping your high-paid investment banking job in London and going all in. So he came back with a list of like 12 to 15 questions.
Like a due diligence.
Kind of a due diligence, but these were all questions that you could not somehow take out the risk before, but you could only answer them by doing, by jumping. So we said, okay, this is then not going to work. And eventually we found Christian, our third founder, who was a colleague of Philip from McKinsey, who was also interested and passionate about the idea. And there we had our team.
So you had the idea, you had the team. How were the first few months? So like, how did you kind of validate the idea or brainstorm about how the concept should be live?
Yeah. So we started in my little apartment in Cologne, actually. And Philip, he moved basically in my little apartment, slept there on the mattress, and we put up a whiteboard to design like what we plan to do.
So this is the garage.
Yeah, exactly. That's my little flat there. Then eventually Christian, he joined, and we said, okay, we need more space. It doesn't work on like 30 square meters. Because our idea was to live together and work together. And the guys had this idea of a boot camp. Yeah? So they were both from consulting, and that's a very popular thing to get people started, really pumped up and energetic. And that's what we did. Yeah? So we were looking for a place to stay. And funnily enough, Philip's brother, he is a veterinarian for horses. He had this great connections to someone who is running this castle, the Burg Münchhausen, which is close to Bonn and on the countryside. It's a place for horseback riding, basically. And that's where we found our little apartment. And it actually was not so posh as it looked here, because we were actually in this little house right next to it in one apartment. And our rooms looked kind of very basic, mattress on the floor. And we made like pizza in the oven and kind of we had a view on the on the castle.
That's a pretty but nice office view, I would say.
But of course, then we were selling the story differently, putting our suits on and things like that you also wouldn't do again in these days. But we didn't know better back then.
And how long did the bootcamp phase?
So that was 4 months. Okay. And it was a time where we basically developed our business plan, where we tried to validate our idea by talking to our friends that were somewhere living around the world, leading this expat life. And we also came up with the very first version of how we imagined our website to be. You have to imagine, we were all guys with no experience in tech at all and how to build a website. So what we did, we created this PowerPoint.
But you were a great consultant.
Yeah, they were great in producing PowerPoint slides. So we came up with this 200-page long PowerPoint presentation about our website, how it should look like, which features it should have, and it was, how you call it in German, the eierlegende Wollmilchsau. Yeah? It really had every facet that you can dream of, even more than we have today.
But 200 pages is a quite extensive website platform.
So that's what we did in these 4 months in this castle.
Okay, and so the next stage is like you go live then? Like you launch the website in 200 pages?
Not exactly. No, what we did then first was the topic was funding, because I had this Gründungszuschuss, and we needed someone to pay this agency, because we already kind of hired them to do it, but we didn't have the money to pay them. Actually, a little bit we had, but we were very bold about it, yeah, and said, yeah, no problem, we will get the money, and we are cool guys.
So and just to come back on an idea, over 200 pages of paper.
Yeah, that's what we had.
Okay.
And we were absolutely sure that we would share this passion with the investors, which was kind of naive, I guess. But that's what we focused on then. Mm-hmm. And so we were thinking about, we need to get some angel investment on board to get started. And we were in the very lucky situation that we got a quick and easy intro to Oliver Zamba, who is one of the leading angels in this tech scene here in Germany. And that was quite interesting.
Everyone is familiar with Oliver
Zamba.
Yeah,
I think people
by now.
know him by now for running a Rocket Internet. So he seemed to like the idea, and he invited us to come visit him in his house. It's a villa at the Starnberger See. All three brothers have their houses there right next to each other. And he invited us to come there, and we prepared. We put on our jacket, and we had this nice PowerPoint deck with our business plan, like the way you should do it. Really prepared for it to give like this presentation and to do this wonderful pitch. So he welcomed us on his terrace. The kids were playing in the background in the yard. And he basically didn't want to have any kind of presentation. He just shot like 10, 15 questions at us in a really fast manner. And I must say they were very good questions, looking back at that time. And after like 10, 15 minutes, he made us an offer. He made us an offer and said, okay, you guys, I understand Xing for expats. Yeah, that's how he called it. This is my offer. Take it or let me know within the next 24 hours.
Okay.
And that's how we actually got our first funding.
Our first check.
And it was good to have them on board because back then they helped us to bring in additional investors like Holdspring Ventures, mm-hmm. who is our lead investor still today, and also a couple of other shareholders.
So they were already known enough to be able to kind of guarantee the quality
yeah.
of their investment?
Absolutely. Back then, the model was still a little bit different. It was more that a team with an idea came to them, and then they funded it and took a minority share in the company. Now with Rocket Internet, it's the other way around, I would say. But back then, they were well known and had very good relations to help us get the other investors on board.
Okay. So what did you do with that money then?
Well, that was the first funding that we could use to hire people.
Okay.
Lots of interns, and for basically paying the agency.
Yeah. To develop the website.
And
200 pages.
And finance our operations, pay our office. Mm-hmm. We then moved to Munich, and had to pay our office and this kind of things.
Okay, so then you were able to be live. I guess where actually was everything launched and where?
So we went online on September 11th. Exactly, it was a coincidence, the date. We actually planned for the 1st of September, but in tech, yeah, everything usually takes a little bit longer. So 11 days was actually quite good. Yeah, but we went online on that day, and that was the very first website. It doesn't.
I must say, it looks very much like the
yeah,
PowerPoint.
Yeah, it looks actually not so different from what we had designed in our PowerPoint. We had to convince the engineers from the agency a bit, but we were paying in the end. So that's what we built, and that's when Internations was born and going live.
Okay. So how did it work at the time? What was the business model? Because it's kind of an it's still a platform, it's still a network.
Yeah.
How do you bring the first members? How do you get to be known and attract people to sign in?
Yeah, so, well, we had the funding and we had the website. So for us, the first step was really to reach the proof of concept, how we called it, to make sure that these people that we wanted to have on the platform will really make use of it
mm-hmm.
And are active on it.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought about how can we do that? So we had this great idea. It was really an amazing idea, I think, because we said, okay, we just have to identify 50 super connected people and tell them about our idea, and then they will invite their friends, and if they only invite like 15 people, and then they continue inviting their friends, then at the end of, we had, this is actually a slide from this very first deck that we presented to these investors, and then it's an easy thing, because it will explode, yeah? It was a perfect theory, but of course, because in reality, it didn't work like that at all. It was a lot more challenging to get these first people to buy into this idea. It was
for free.
It was for free, yeah, of course. There were friends and there were people who were as passionate about the idea as we were. Why wouldn't they? Yeah, because they had other things to do. They didn't care about it so much as we did. So that was not so easy. But eventually, we had a lot of friends who invited their friends. We also came up with our ambassador position, which were members who were very well connected in our local communities, who would invite their friends. And this is how we got some viral mechanism going in the very beginning. And that's what brought us our very first members.
But so you didn't actually have a go-to-market strategy, which was to focus on one specific city and then go to the next, or focus on one specific country and then go to the next. You just like spread the word around.
No, we wanted to conquer the world, yeah?
As every entrepreneur,
of course. So we started basically with 237 communities, basically all major international cities. Would be cities like Barcelona and Madrid and Spain, Milan and Rome. So the major cities.
And, remember, we're in 2007.
Yeah, 2007.
At the time.
And the beauty was we were global, a global company from day one. Yeah, was feeling really good. But it was an empty network, yeah. And there's nothing more boring than to go to a website. There's no traction, no traffic, nothing going on. So that was indeed challenging. But we basically spread it all around the world and took everyone that we could get, yeah, without a special focus only on Germany or only on a certain city.
And then, so from the word of mouth, did you actually use any of the usual search or tools that you use in social media? I mean, we're 2007, so yeah. Was that existing or?
Yeah, we changed our marketing approach because we started out as an invitation-only community, mm-hmm. meaning you could only become a member if you were being invited by another member. We wanted to create a community of trust, as we called it, where you could really rely on the information that you get from another member if you're interested in finding a babysitter in Kuala Lumpur or something like that. So we had a good set of first members, very high quality, but eventually people that were hearing about it, they couldn't even join the website. And wanting to
very
grow...
Very VIP.
Yeah, this was not so smart. So what we did is then we kind of softened this approach and said, okay, there's a way where you can, bless you, where you can apply to become a member of Internations. And this is still what we are doing today in a different way. We have now a moderated registration process where our team still makes sure that only the right people join the mm-hmm. community. And that's where we then started to address search engine advertising, as you can see here, optimization for Google search, and also doing advertising on Facebook to target expats all around the globe, basically.
And by then, you had how many members?
By then, I think we had maybe the first 70,000-80,000 members, I would say.
And yeah. Again, everything for free.
Everything was for free.
So yeah, you were still relying on the funding from the Zammer Brother
absolutely.
And Halsberg Venture.
Yeah.
And at some point, what happened? Because you need to have some monetization, right?
So basically the thinking back then was more, and that was not uncommon, to build your website and your, especially in social networking, drive growth and traffic and traction, and then monetization will come later.
That was the principle at the time.
It was a principle at the time, and we were full in this flow. And that's a nice model because you're basically just focus on growth. But the problem is in this model that you're dependent on continuous funding, which we, as bold as we were, thought it was not a problem. Because it was so easy in the first place. So the problem was that back then, what happened was that there was the financial crisis in 2008. Mm-hmm. And while first we had a lot of positive feedback from shareholders, and we were talking about great valuations for the company, all of a sudden, this interest completely changed. It vanished. And people were telling us, yeah, sorry, but we really consolidate our portfolio right now. We don't do so many new investments. And that was a time when we couldn't get more funding. And we needed it because we...
had no monetization.
Yeah, exactly. And we were just spending money eventually. And I actually took a screenshot of our bank account back then. And it was kind of... yeah, not such a nice feeling seeing money going out and no more money, no money's coming in. So that was definitely quite a tough time.
At this point in time, did you figure that it was kind of a, you were kind of getting into the wall? Did you see at some point that you had to, how many people were actually at Internation at that time?
Yeah, maybe there we were around 15 people or so.
15, okay.
I would say the core team. And yeah, definitely. I mean, that was a situation where we saw us running ourselves out of money. We had to pay our rent and the agency and our team and salaries. And that was not so easy. So what we did, the logical things, we didn't pay any salary for ourselves anymore. And that's the first thing you kind of cut as an entrepreneur. We also, unfortunately, had to let go of some people in this phase because we couldn't keep up with this spending level. And, of course, canceled any kind of short-term contract that was not critical.
And how did you drive your team actually to continue, like, to motivate them that there was actually kind of a sustainable way at some point to...
Yeah, I think as from the very beginning, because we were very passionate about our idea and we thought this challenge that we're facing now is not because our model is not working and our vision is still true, but basically we're just lacking a minor detail of the whole thing, which is the money. So this is just a very important, actually, technical factor which kept us from achieving what we wanted to do. And our team shared this vision, and they didn't feel like giving up without really trying to ever monetize it.
This is at the same time where one of your co-founders, if I remember correctly, 2009, also left, right? So, I mean, yeah, you say the team was having this vision, but yeah. When one of your co-founders leaves, it doesn't give a good sentiment or feeling to the rest of the team, I guess. So how do you deal with this?
Yeah, that was a major drawback. That happened exactly at the same time. Christian told us, listen, guys, I know this is not so nice for you right now, but I will leave until the end of the year.
Was it related to the financial crisis and the fact that you couldn't get the money?
I think it was different reasons. We were then in there for basically 2 years, and his family circumstances changed. He became a father, so his risk
appetite
kind of changed, which is fully understandable. He also said that it was a very interesting learning experience to building it up, but sees himself more on the corporate side, that's where he is also today. And that was a hard message for us and also for our team, because if a founder is leaving, then...
How do you keep the motivation?
Yeah, they wonder, like, okay, what's the problem?
Yeah.
Doesn't he believe in the idea anymore? Yeah.
So you're still here and alive with the platform, so
exactly.
I think people would like to know how you made things change.
No, we were lucky that we could actually eventually find additional investors and also existing shareholders. They gave us additional funding at that time, and we split up the tasks that Christian was doing between the two of us, which was, of course, a big challenge in the very beginning, but eventually we managed, you have to. And then what we did was to completely switch our focus from focusing on growth to monetization. Because we said we don't want to end up in this situation again ever. So we had to make money, yeah? And we have to be self-sustainable. Mm-hmm. So what we did is early in 2009, then we introduced the opportunity for sponsors and advertising partners to advertise on Internations. And the good thing was that expats are a very interesting target group for a lot of companies, because they usually have a higher education, good income. Mm-hmm. So we managed to ensure, actually, The Economist as our very first advertising partner, a very reputable brand. That helped us to then get other partners as well. So that was the first topic. And the second one was to introduce our premium membership, which was the very initial plan anyway, to have like a freemium model where the basic membership would be for free and the premium membership would enable you to have access to certain features and benefits and would cost a certain fee.
And just one question regarding the partnerships and your existing investors. Who came first? Did you have to convince your existing investor to come on board, to convince then the new investor to come on board, or did your existing investor also did their mm-hmm. part of the job by trying to bring more people in so that they also can would not have to pay for the entire bill?
So what is always great, if you can approach new investors, telling them that the existing ones also put money on the table.
Of course, yeah.
That makes the story a lot easier than if they don't. So we were in the lucky situation that they were willing to do it if we would find others to put some money on the table as well. And so we had their commitment.
Okay.
To do it in the case that we would find someone, which strengthened our case.
And did that also strengthen the way you could go after partnerships and like going back to the partners that you were able to find, the fact that you were backed up by renowned investors?
You mean for the advertising partners?
Yeah.
Or not so much. They didn't really care about that so much.
So they care about the business model
and
the community that they could
like
target.
Because these are people who are interested in advertising.
Yeah.
And they think about, is this my target group? What do I pay? What do we get out of it? And it was a different focus.
Okay. Yeah. So you introducing the paying option. Was that an easy sell to the existing members? how did you make them like pay when something was for free for the beginning?
Yeah, so we sold it that basically until then everyone was a premium member, and then from day one to day two, no one was a premium member anymore, but you had to pay to become a premium member. So we the idea was to give them something and then take it away. And that was working okay. And something that really fundamentally changed this was that we pivoted our model a little bit in the way that we emphasized more this whole offline component.
Mm-hmm.
So when we did our very first initial version of the business plan, it was a social network, similar to Facebook or Xing or something, very online and digital. But what we saw in our forums was that people were writing each other, hey, let's meet up and go for a coffee. Let's go out and meet for drinks. And there we said, okay, this is something that obviously the members want to do. Let's support that. So what we did is that we built an event calendar, mm-hmm. and we basically gave our ambassadors a new task to organize events and get-togethers on a regular level. And this became very popular. So they started organizing events with like 10 people meeting up, and then they brought more, 15, 20, and then 50, 100, and now there are some 200, 300, 400, 500 people meeting up in like all of our 390 communities. And we made that part of the premium membership by introducing a cover charge for these events. And you would have an additional incentive to become a premium member because you could join for free.
So basically, by reverting back from the premium, you're not premium anymore, it's you have to pay, you're providing additional value.
Exactly.
Right? So having like this offline group, I think you also mentioned hosting events, having these type of activities, there's also like a lot more value that you get out of the platform, and it's not purely online, but also offline.
Yeah, it was a beautiful combination because it's nice to discover people online, but especially when you're in the situation living in another country, you want to meet new people, and in the end, to really make meaningful contacts, or as you call it, friends, you need to meet people in real life. And that's what we enabled with these events and these get-togethers. It was a physical way for people to meet up all around the globe, and that was really a step changer for us.
Okay. Can you actually share how many paying members you have?
No, I'm sorry, I can't.
But okay.
But it's a good question to ask.
I tried. So now we're in 2017, and of course social media has quite evolved. How do you differentiate yourself against the other social media platform? And we know, of course, Facebook, we know the more professional one, like seeing LinkedIn, we know the dating apps, Tinder happen. So how do you, what are the key differentiating factors that where like your value is a little bit different from all the other?
Well, I think there's quite a few things. One is definitely this offline component that you don't have with the other networks, that you have a chance to meet people in real life is something that you don't find on other networks like Facebook and LinkedIn, for example. Of course, there are some groups and activities that do that, but that's not the focus. The other thing is that a network like Facebook has become basically an infrastructure for communication, a place where everyone is on and where people communicate and stay in contact with the friends that they have for a long time, mostly focusing on the private sector, changing that now. But LinkedIn, on the other hand, focusing completely on the professional networking, on recruiting and sales, basically. So what we do, we focus from early on this group of expats that have a very significant issue and a very... the expat status is a dominating factor in their life. So this is why I think it's a very sustainable model that really is now persisting since more than 10 years now. While many other startups and social networks that started together with us, because it was a boom of social networks, there were networks for horse lovers, for doctors, for even for cats, and things like that, that vanished over time. Or somehow twisted their business model into something different. But I think this focus on the expat space, on this living in the situation, is something that that works very well for us.
Okay, so now you have how many members?
Now we have 2.5 million members.
Okay, present in, you said, 390 communities?
Yes, that's correct.
What's next? What do you see Internation, like you see them growing further, adding new features?
So basically what we always have been doing is to listen to our members and see what they want. So I travel a lot to our events and to visit our communities and talk to them. And we, of course, can survey our members and ask them for what they want. And that's what we've been doing consistently. So we came up with these activities where you can meet up in smaller groups and meet up for different things like hiking or salsa dancing, things like that. And now, thinking more in the future, what we are aiming to do is to basically become, as we say it, every expat's best friend. And by meaning everyone, I really mean everyone. So we believe that there are about 50 to 60 million people that we classify as expats. And as we have now 2.5 million, we want to have all of them to be an active member of Internations, or at least as many as possible. So we want to grow further and have more of them on our platform and have a similar active community life as we have it in major cities like London, Dubai, Singapore, also Munich, also in smaller communities like Pyongyang, North Korea, or Ouagadougou, where we have communities. And on the other hand, we also want to accompany our expats on every step of their journey. So while we focus today very much on social integration, not being alone, and providing them with information, there's a lot of challenges that you face when you're being an expat, even before moving. I have to find my apartment, I have to get a visa, I have to get like an international health insurance, a bank account, things like that. That's where we want to add additional value for expats all around the world.
Yeah, and I've also come from stories that people have met their wives and husbands through Internation.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is also the fact that you asked me in one of our earlier conversations, what is the thing that that drives me personally forward? And this is definitely the topic that I see that what we do has a significant impact on people's lives. Yeah? So when I go to these events, people approach me and tell me, hey, I really want to thank you. I've met my very best friends here in Kinshasa, and that's so great. Or I have found my job through Internations, or a business partner, and we now started this project, or my apartment, or, yeah, also people, like even tonight, someone was here, told me that he met the love of his life, getting married, and there are quite a few Internations babies out there. It's not that we want to position it in this way, but whenever there's a lot of people meeting, this naturally happens, and this is really giving a lot of purpose to me and my entire team, and makes it very nice.
So in the next 5-10 years, when we will celebrate the 20 years of Internation, we should see you still as the CEO of Internation continuing this journey?
Hopefully, yes.
What can you bring to the social, to the local community here in Munich? Like, what are the key kind of lessons?
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, I don't know if anyone knows, but Internation is actually based here in Munich, in a couple of blocks away from here, next
to the Central Station,
and Theresienwiese. And you've been basically building the company here and not moving, staying in the same building since day one.
Yeah, well, we started in a little office at the Viktualienmarkt, then we moved to the Central Station area. We have now a team of a little bit more than 100 team members in our office here in Munich, a very international team from more than different 30 nations, and that's also a great atmosphere to work in. I think when it comes to the Munich startup scene and community, I like to pass on any kind of knowledge that people are interested in about learnings, about contacts, about the challenges and the learnings, basically. I do these kind of talks once in a while if someone asks and is interested about it. And I'm part of a similar network, the Entrepreneurs Organization, which is for entrepreneurs where they exchange experiences, challenges, and are set out to learning together and personal development. And that's basically what I like to do in this area.
And for the first time or serial entrepreneurs here present tonight, what would be your key lessons learned over this journey at Internation?
Well, it's an endless learning experience, I would say, and it's very different learnings because as an entrepreneur, you learn everything through the different stages of a company. It's very different from starting up a company, yeah, from the very first beginning. You learn that it's not so efficient to go with three founders to IKEA and buy the furniture. Simple stuff like that. So the very early beginning to growing a company and establishing processes with now the more than 100 employees that are more sophisticated and more efficient, you learn a lot in that aspect. You also learn a lot about the different facets of the different functions because it's about developing the product, getting funding and financing, how to hire the right people, how to market basically your product. So there's a lot of topics that you that are facing or posing challenges to you on a daily level. So you learn quite a lot, and that is also very very rewarding. And if you ask me about very concrete advice for starting up an own company, there's definitely a couple of things that at least for me are true. One thing is to pick a topic that you're really passionate about. Yeah. So for me, the focus was not, okay, what is the most beautiful business model from just a pure financial perspective, but what am I personally passionate about? And because usually I believe that if you do that, then you do it good because you enjoy doing it. And then eventually you will find other people who like that as well. Then pick a problem that is relevant to more than you, ideally. And ideally that you can explain in ideally one sentence. That is very easy to understand. It's good if it's a scalable business model. Definitely that. It's of major importance to bet on the right people for your initial founding team, people that you can rely on, that share your vision, that have the kind same kind of mindset, and also hiring the right people early that help you grow your business from the very beginning. And another important factor is to always listen to your customers and start that very early on. Yeah, so also for us in the very beginning, we didn't want to share our idea with anyone. We always came up with these NDAs, non-disclosure agreements. But first of all, the VCs, they didn't care about it. They were sharing that anyways. And it is also helpful to get immediate feedback from your friends, from colleagues, from people in that industry to validate if that's good what you're doing and to eventually twist it and shape it a bit. So these are maybe some of the more general learnings.
Very valuable. Thanks a lot.